Good evening. My name is Kieran Zelbo, and I'm chair of OUTLaw this year. I'd like to thank you all for joining us as we honor this year's OUTLaw Alum of the Year awardee, Shana Knizhnik. It's wonderful to see so many familiar faces, and I'm so excited to meet all of you who I don't already know. On behalf of OUTLaw, I'd like to extend a warm welcome to all of you, students, alumni, faculty, staff, and prospective students who are joining us here tonight. As chair of OUTLaw, it is a privilege to work with so many wonderful queer law students, and I'm so proud of my peers who remind us that queer and trans liberation goes hand in hand with liberation from oppression in all of its forms, including anti-blackness, xenophobia, and colonialism. OUTLaw is one of the oldest affinity groups at NYU Law. We strive to be persistent advocates and organizers for the LGBTQIA+ community in the law school and beyond. As many of you may know, our programming includes education, service, activism, fostering community, and coalition building with other organizations. Tonight is a special moment for us to celebrate the accomplishments of all of our inspiring alum and to recognize the incredible work that Shana Knizhnik has done in advocating for the LGBTQIA+ people and other marginalized communities. Now, please welcome the Dean of NYU School of Law, Troy McKenzie.
Thank you. And thank you, everyone, for joining this evening. It is wonderful to see everyone here for this year's OUTLaw Alumni Reception. This is one of the most exceptional alumni gatherings that we look forward to every year. This is now my second year as dean and my second OUTLaw Alumni Reception as dean. And at NYU, we are extraordinarily proud to be a place where all dimensions of diversity are celebrated and where people of different backgrounds can exchange views in a respectful environment. We are also very proud of the long history of advancing the LGBTQIA+ community and equality going far, far, far earlier than our peer schools. In 1978, NYU became the very first law school in the United States to ensure that its career services offices would not be open to employers who discriminated on the basis of sexual orientation. Now, perhaps we take that for granted today, but in 1978, that was an almost revolutionary idea. Over the years, the law school also had policies that denied employers the ability to interview if they discriminated on the basis of race, gender, religion, national origin, or disability. And that addition in 1978 was a marker and an innovation for the rest of legal education. When I first joined the faculty back in 2007, I remember the dean at the time, Ricky Rivez, talking about the Solomon Amendment, which was a provision of federal law under which the government threatened to cut funding to universities that would not cooperate with military recruiters on campus. And this was at a time when Don't Ask, Don't Tell was still in effect. And NYU took the position that the rule we had adopted since 1978 applied to all potential employers of lawyers graduating from this law school. And Dean Rivez, with unanimous support of our faculty, regardless of their viewpoints, regardless of any differences across faculty, Ricky agreed to litigate that case all the way to the Supreme Court. And we lost. But as he has said over the years, we are proud that although we may have lost the battle, ultimately the wider war was won. And we remain committed to having an engaged student body that is diverse, that offers equal opportunity to everyone. And OUTLaw is a cornerstone of that commitment and that project. I'm especially happy and gratified this evening to see that Shana Knizhnik is being honored. Shana was my student in civil procedure. And I remember fall of 2012. I also remember that Shana and some of her classmates began talking about this idea that I thought was really quite silly, Notorious R.B.G. That it was born here at NYU School of Law. And I assume that like 5 people would get the joke and maybe 10 more people would know about it. But Shana, being Shana, took it, ran with it, and became co-author of Notorious R.B.G., The Life and Times of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Was able to take a moment of hilarity in 1L and turn it into something substantive and quite moving. One other note about Shana, I think the last time I saw Shana was when I got called for jury duty several years ago. And it was a particularly large veneer. So if you get called for jury duty in state Supreme Court, you know, you get called down and you're sort of sitting in the rows of seats, and I was all the way in the back. I couldn't see anybody up front. And the judge, after about an hour of some preliminary matters, said, well, let me just introduce the defendants and also the lawyers who are prosecuting and defending the case. And the judge described himself. In the very, very unlikely event that you know anyone up here, please indicate. And I couldn't see, and he said, and of course, Shana Knizhnik is defending, and I stood up and I said very sheepishly, I know Ms. Knizhnik. The judge looked at me as if I was obviously just trying to slink out of jury duty and turned to Shana, and Shana went. And I went home. I will say, by the way, for anyone who thinks I was trying to get out of jury duty, I had actually postponed to that week because it was 2 weeks before the start of class, and I thought, hey, if I get called for jury duty, I can actually serve. So I was really trying to do my best and my duty. So again, I'm really, really, really thrilled that Shana is being honored in this way. I'm very grateful to the talented and enthusiastic group of students and alumni who have built this community. And this is a celebration of all of you. I now want to turn things over to Ari.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you to all the wonderful alumni, students, and event staff that came out tonight to celebrate the many accomplishments of the LGBTQ community at NYU. My name is Ari Paparonis, and I'm a 1L representative for OUTLaw this year. This year, I had the pleasure of being part of the committee who had the opportunity to select who to honor as this year's OUTLaw Alumni of the Year Award. This was an inspiring yet challenging task, considering there are countless alumni of NYU's OUTLaw program doing impactful work in the public, private, and government sectors, as well as the legal academy, politics, and even those who have escaped the legal profession altogether. We considered nominating an oyster farmer living in Alabama for a second. After exploring the careers of a number of outstanding nominees, this year we are thrilled to present the 2024 OUTLaw Alumna of the Year Award to Shana Knizhnik. Shana graduated cum laude from NYU Law School in 2015, where she was an articles editor of the NYU Law Review, served on the boards of OUTLaw, the Coalition of Law on Law and Representation, and also was a member of the Defender Collective, the annual Law Review show, and Substantial Performance a cappella group. As a student, Shana also interned at the ACLU, the Legal Aid Society, and the Public Defender Service of Washington, D.C. And she was also a semifinalist in the moot court competition. As if that wasn't enough to keep her busy, while still a law student, Shana created the Notorious R.B.G. Tumblr account, a website dedicated to exploring the life, career, and notorious dissents of the late Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Within her first few days of posting, Shana's blog and the Notorious R.B.G. meme quickly went viral and gained national attention. Like any savvy content creator today, Shana created the Notorious R.B.G. merchandise to go along with the blog, selling nearly 2,000 shirts in the first 2 months of sales. In October 2015, just 5 months after graduating law school, Shana, along with MSNBC journalist Irene Karen, published their book, The Notorious R.B.G., The Life and Times of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, which became a New York Times bestseller. In 2016, Shana was named to Forbes 30 Under 30 list in media. Shana later appeared in the Oscar-nominated documentary R.B.G., which was inspired in part by her book. She is widely credited with bringing attention to Justice Ginsburg's life and tenure on the court, and has sparked nuanced conversations that continue today about the late justice's legacy, both the good and the bad. Apart from being a best-selling author, documentary star, and meme connoisseur, Shana has a very accomplished legal career. After graduating, Shana was a law clerk to Judge Dolores Lovitar on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Third Circuit. Following her clerkship, Shana worked as a fellow at the ACLU of the District of Columbia for 2 years. Shana is currently a staff attorney at the Legal Aid Society's criminal defense practice, where she began as a public defender in Manhattan in 2018, advocating for the rights of marginalized and disenfranchised people in our criminal justice system, work that is even more worthy of respect and celebration than being a New York Times bestseller, in my view. Shana has continued to be a voice for the LGBTQ community throughout her career through media and advocacy. In 2011, Shana was a founding member of the youth advocacy group Interact, the largest advocacy organization in the United States working to promote the rights of intersex youth. And in 2020, Shana's article, Coming Out as Intersex After Years of Keeping It a Secret, was published in Teen Vogue. In 2022, Shana acted as consulting producer for the documentary feature Everybody, produced by Focus Features, a groundbreaking film that explored the lives and experiences of intersex people and the history of the intersex rights movement. Shana is an alumna who truly exemplifies the values of service, community, representation, and liberation in her career. These qualities are especially important to celebrate and acknowledge today, at a time where, despite decades of progress, there is growing bias in legislation targeting LGBTQ people. And for those of us who are trans, gender nonconforming, or intersex, this bias can feel 100-fold, and sometimes it is. Yet, it is alumni like Shana who remind us that by being honest, open, caring, passionate, and hardworking, you can make an impact in any space. Please join me in congratulating the 2024 OUTLaw Alumna of the Year, Shana Knizhnik.
Thank you so much for that introduction, Ari, and thank you to OUTLaw for this honor. I feel extremely grateful for this recognition and also extremely humbled given the impressive contributions of those who have received this award before me, but I will do my best to push past the imposter syndrome and embody all that is gay and lawyerly until I have to pass on the title next year. I'm not gonna lie, I'm a little bit disappointed there's no crown. As Dean McKenzie mentioned, I was a member of both Substantial Performance and the Law Review musical, but sadly, I must inform everyone I'm not going to be lip-syncing for my life at tonight's ceremony. In all seriousness, it's truly an honor to receive this award. 11 years ago, when the very first OUTLaw Alumni Award was given out, I was in this very room in the audience, awaiting my fill of NYU catering cheese and crackers like a good law student. So it's a real full circle moment. I remember being so excited to start law school at NYU. It felt like a lifetime in the making. I was one of those kids to whom everyone would say, "You should be a lawyer." I later learned that this really just meant I was an extremely annoying child who would not stop arguing with adults. But suddenly, I was in a room full of other annoying kids. It felt like the culmination of my destiny. In reality, it was just the beginning. As soon as I began law school, I knew I was going to be involved in OUTLaw. I had only come out as gay 2 years before, after graduating college in 2010, but I had spent 2 years immersing myself in the Brooklyn queer community, and I knew that I wanted to find like-minded queers at NYU. I needed to find the gays. And in addition to the aforementioned musical performance groups, I found them in OUTLaw. Being a queer law student at the time felt pretty exciting. My law school experience coincided with what felt like a sea shift in terms of rights and visibility for LGBTQ Americans, at least in the realm of marriage equality, which was the most publicly salient issue at the time. I started law school in 2012, 1 year after New York State legalized gay marriage, only the sixth state to do so. Legalized gay was stamped on the windows of the American Apparel that still existed on Broadway. That November, several states passed referenda legalizing marriage equality, and Barack Obama was elected to his second term in office. In December, the US Supreme Court granted cert in Windsor and Perry, the cases involving the constitutionality of the Federal Defense of Marriage Act, and also Proposition 8. The following semester, just after oral arguments had taken place in those cases, NYU's chapter of the Federalist Society held an event entitled Debate on the Defense of Marriage, featuring an anti-gay talking head, Ryan T. Anderson. And rather than deign to acknowledge the event with a serious response, OUTLaw held a parody event on the same day, Debate on the Defense of Martinis, in which the question presented was whether a martini was necessarily the union of gin and vermouth, or whether vodka and other alternate intoxicating unions should be recognized. You can take a guess at which event was better attended. That summer, on June 26, 2013, while I was doing my first summer internship, I was doing death penalty post-conviction work in San Francisco, a majority of the Supreme Court sided with marriage equality advocates in both Windsor and Perry. I attended San Francisco Pride that weekend. Gays were getting married and people were celebrating. The day before the court decided Windsor and Perry, on June 25th, 2013, another decision was announced that got a bit less attention at Pride celebrations, but had perhaps even broader implications for the future of our country, Shelby County versus Holder. Chief Justice Roberts wrote for the five-justice majority, striking down Section 5 of the Voting Rights Act of 1965, the preclearance provision that provided a check on states and jurisdictions with histories of voter discrimination, essentially under the theory that racism was no longer significant enough to justify it. Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg not only wrote the dissent in that case, she announced it from the bench, breaking a Supreme Court record in doing so. She said getting rid of preclearance when it had been successful and was continuing to prevent voter discrimination was like getting rid of your umbrella in a rainstorm because you're not getting wet. That evening, I designed a t-shirt and I started a Tumblr, a social media blogging platform that at the time had to be explained to older audiences, but now is somewhat of a piece of millennial nostalgia. I called it Notorious R.B.G., a pun on the late Notorious B.I.G., and that quote from Shelby County was the very first post. The rest, as they say, is history. What started as mostly a joke took off in a way that I could never have imagined and came to define my life in many ways. The blog immediately blew up. There was a New York Magazine piece about it, and me 3 days later. I kept it going during 2L year, posting briefs, excerpts from Justice Ginsburg's briefs as an attorney at the ACLU Women's Rights Project. And of course, there was a steady stream of memes and fam-created art in the justice's honor. The fall of my 3L year, I was approached by an editor at HarperCollins about turning the blog into a book, and I said, sure, but also I'm in law school, so I don't know that I'm gonna be able to do this by myself. So I was ultimately connected to my co-author, journalist Erin Carmone. We reported and wrote the book during my 3L year and finished it as I was studying for the bar exam, which is also when the Supreme Court decided Obergefell v. Hodges, making marriage equality the law of the land. We submitted final edits to the book just days before I took the bar. Let's just say I did not get very much sleep that year. The book was published that fall in 2015, in October, while I was clerking in Philadelphia. The days surrounding the book's release in particular felt like I was living someone else's life. I was suddenly on MSNBC talking to Joe Scarborough about why millennials were connecting with Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg. A year later, we started working with the Skirball Center in Los Angeles to make it into a museum exhibition. A year after that, I was interviewed by Julie Cohen and Betsy West, the directors of the documentary feature RBG. All of this felt surreal in so many ways. It was particularly strange in that it became such a part of my identity, and certainly my public identity, even though being the creator of Notorious RBG was always very much a side gig. And shockingly, my politics and worldview are not coextensive with Justice Ginsburg's. If you can believe it, I did not come to law school to become a Ruth Bader Ginsburg meme creator and biographer. I came with an interest in civil rights and in doing what it is I do now, being a public defender. My interest in public defense was initially sparked by a mentor, a friend, and fellow NYU Law alum, now a federal defender in Brooklyn, then a public defender at Legal Aid's Bronx office. When I graduated from law school, Michelle Alexander's The New Jim Crow had just been released. And I wanted to fight against an unjust system of mass incarceration stacked against poor people of color. And being able to use my skills in trial advocacy to do so felt like a perfect match. At NYU, I participated in the Defender Collective and the Suspension Representation Project. I was in the Racial Justice Clinic. And then in 3L year, I did the Juvenile Defender Clinic with Professor and Vice Dean Randy Hertz. I got to take Eighth Amendment law and litigation with Brian Stevenson, who tells us that the opposite of poverty isn't wealth, it's justice. In addition to marriage equality, my time at NYU also coincided with the birth of the Black Lives Matter movement. Trayvon Martin was killed during my second semester of 1L, and his killer was acquitted that July. The following summer, Eric Garner was choked to death by an NYPD officer in Staten Island, and Michael Brown was gunned down by a police officer in Ferguson, Missouri. During the fall of my 3L year, Akai Gurley was shot and killed by an officer in Brooklyn. And my final semester, Freddie Gray was killed in police custody in Baltimore, and Walter Scott was killed while running away from police officers in North Charleston, South Carolina. And just before I took the bar exam, Sandra Bland died while in police custody in Waller County, Texas. These names and stories and countless others that came before and since came to encapsulate the system I wanted to fight against, a system that grew out of our country's original sin of chattel slavery, a system that allows police and other officials through qualified immunity and other legal and institutional insulation to get away with egregious misconduct with no consequences, a system that sees Black and Brown people as guilty until proven innocent. As a public defender, I do work against that system, but in many ways, I'm also a part of it. That tension is something that I have to grapple with every day, trying to engage in harm reduction in a system that I see as overwhelmingly harmful. For me, my clients are the reason I do the work that I do. The system is a conveyor belt that is more interested in efficiently grinding people in and out than in addressing any of the problems that people actually face. Being able to make a human connection with every person I represent is so crucial to feeling like I and hopefully they are not just a nameless cogs in that system. I often describe public defense as the ER of law. You're meeting people literally in the middle of an emergency. They've been arrested, they're being charged with a crime, everything is in triage mode. People's real lives, their liberty, their ability to make a living, to stay with their families are in your hands. Boundaries and normal work hours are fictions. And obviously, the injustices of the criminal legal system are most apparent when people caught in it are otherwise sympathetic and accused of low-level, nonviolent charges. But of course, the ability and willingness to defend anyone accused of anything and to do so zealously is what the job requires. As Professor Stevenson tells us, each of us is more than the worst thing that we've ever done. Ultimately, I believe that this work is about centering humanity, the humanity of those that society is willing to ignore, whose subjugation and disposability many people are willing to accept. And contrary to popular belief, it doesn't require, in some perverse cosmic balance, to discard the humanity of those who have experienced harm and even violence at the hands of another. Rather, it acknowledges that the root causes of harm and victimization are not solved by throwing human beings in cages, enacting violence against them, and acknowledges that incarceration only serves to perpetuate the harm and violence. As Angela Davis tells us, prisons do not disappear social problems, they disappear human beings. As the current mayor of New York City defunds libraries and schools but continues to inflate the budget for NYPD while vetoing laws like the How Many Stops Act that require officers to document their interactions with the public, public defenders are using our skills as lawyers in collaboration with social workers, investigators, paralegals, and impacted family and community members to do more with less. I'm proud to stand by my clients in their full humanity every day. I've come to believe that embracing humanity in all its complexity, its fallibility, is necessary, not just to public defense, but in the practice of law and of life. What does it look like to embrace humanity and the universal right to human dignity in our lawyering and in our lives? What does it look like to embrace humility, empathy, and grace, love of the self and of the other? To embrace our own vulnerability, our flaws, our mistakes? To believe that everyone is capable of redemption, of forgiveness, of change? The legal profession values objectivity. As lawyers, it's our job to represent our clients and their interests. We advocate for others using logic and reason. Our own subjectivity, our identities and experiences are not front and center. And in fact, some might even deem them distractions to or detractions from our work. In my own life, I've found it much easier to advocate for those whose experiences are different from my own than to tell my own full story. Throughout my unexpected meme-inspired rise to niche internet fame, which coincided with my legal education and early career as a lawyer, I was, to use a term from Professor Kenji Yoshino, covering. Although many people in law school and other parts of my life saw me as out and proud, I was hiding a part of my identity, of my experience, from almost everyone I knew. A global pandemic that changed every aspect of our lives and an impending divorce. Yes, not satisfied with the right to gay marriage, I ultimately needed to exercise my right to gay divorce. Are what finally pushed me to feel ready to release a secret that had followed me my entire life. In October 2020, in a piece in Teen Vogue, I came out publicly on Intersex Awareness Day as intersex. That means that I, despite being raised as a girl, identifying with womanhood, and now in a somewhat surprising user of she, her pronouns, fall into a category of approximately 1.7% of people born with variations in biological sex characteristics, those being a combination of chromosomes, gonads, genitals, and or hormone function, that don't fall neatly into the categories of male or female. Like many intersex children, as was the standard practice since the 1950s, I was operated on without my consent and also lied to about my condition. And when I was finally told a version of the truth, it was impressed upon me that I didn't need to, i.e. shouldn't, tell anyone. It's not a surprise that my experience of being intersex was later inextricably linked to my experience of my own sexuality. The pressure to conform to a compulsory heteronormative society was immense for anyone, let alone someone who's already desperately trying to pass as a normal girl. My first time coming out, I had initially told a few close friends about my intersex condition in conjunction with my queerness, but then I decided it was too much. Most people didn't need to know everything. I could just be gay. That's not to say I didn't do significant internal work at the time, figuring out my intersex identity and how it intersected, get it, with my queerness. I just did it secretly. The summer after I graduated college, I actually cold emailed Dean Spade, an abolitionist trans law professor at Seattle University and founder of the Sylvia Rivera Law Project, whose work blew my mind. He actually responded and connected me to another trans lawyer, Gabriel Arkles, who was teaching lawyering at the time at NYU. I was trying to figure out all these things, who I was, what I wanted to do, how these things did or didn't overlap. Later, I helped develop the youth advocacy program for Interact, the largest organization in the United States dedicated to the rights of intersex youth. I knew I would probably eventually come out about everything, but the panic that I felt at the idea of doing so was overwhelming. And that became even more true after I became a public figure of sorts. I just kept pushing it off. Coming out publicly as intersex finally allowed me to remove the shroud of secrecy and shame that had defined so much of my life. And it also, in a strange twist of fate, led me back to Julie Cohen, who was one of the directors of the RBG documentary, who just happened to already be working in early 2021 on a feature about three intersex activists. And I signed on as consulting producer, the sole intersex person on the production side of the film. Everybody was released on last year's Tribeca Film Festival and then in theaters. It's now available to stream for free on Amazon Prime. Despite intersex being distinct from trans and non-binary gender identity, it doesn't stop ignorant, anonymous nobodies from expressing transphobic drivel on the internet in some online user reviews of the film. But it has 98% on Rotten Tomatoes, so take that, bigots. Being intersex has given me the opportunity to see beyond prescriptive binaries of all kinds. And coming out publicly allows me to talk about the need for trans intersex solidarity and fighting for bodily autonomy for everyone, particularly in the midst of a widespread legal assault on queer and trans people simply existing like I've never seen in my lifetime. At the beginning of 2021, zero states banned evidence-based, consensual, gender-affirming medical care for minors. And as we stand here in the beginning of 2024, just 3 years later, 22 states have enacted such bans. Almost all of these bans contain explicit exceptions for non-consensual, medically unnecessary surgeries on intersex kids. In other words, trans kids can't get the healthcare they need and want, and in the same breath, intersex kids are being forced to get medical interventions they don't want or need. Think about how perverse that is. It makes plainly clear that these laws are not about protecting children. They're about enforcing a violent binary and punishing anyone who violates it. It's a personal sadness of mine that Justice Ginsburg passed away before my coming out piece was published. In her final term in 2020, she was in the majority in Bostock v. Clayton County, which held that discrimination against transgender people is sex discrimination under Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Now, all of my experiences, including but not limited to being queer, being intersex, being the child of Russian-speaking Jewish refugees from the former Soviet Union, attending Philadelphia public schools, attending New York University Law School, being a public defender, going through a divorce, they all make me the person that I am and have brought me to where I am today. It's an absolute revelation to now be able to bring all of these parts of myself and not just some to everything that I do. I love the concept of chosen family in queer culture, not only because I deeply value my friendships, but because it encapsulates all that is so beautiful about queerness. It represents choosing what our lives look like, building our own families, our own structures, outside of what the straight world tells us that we need. Of course, people don't choose their truths, but they choose to live them. Queerness is infinite. In contrast, the law is inherently finite. Trying to constrain and define and categorize a world of infinite variables, queerness is about imagining a world other than that which exists, whereas the law is about precedent. But I think that that's what makes us queers such good lawyers. Not because we are able to use the master's tools to dismantle the master's house, as Audre Lorde warns us that we cannot do, but because we have all had to learn to use the tools that already exist and to make our own, to survive and thrive in this world, and to envision a better one while doing so. That's incredible to me. The world, the country, the profession that we exist in today feels so different than the one that I graduated law school into, the one in which the notorious RBG phenomenon could represent the hopeful embrace of a woman who had spent her life trying to expand we the people and not a tragic reminder that she died in dissent, with a cavalry of powerful henchmen ready to defy her dying wishes and undo her legacy. Notwithstanding the tendency of flattened internet discourse, where the only binary options are either to immortalize our heroes as superhuman or tear down our enemies as irredeemable villains, RBG was also tragically mortal and human. Despite our lofty beliefs as lawyers in the power of words, of logic and persuasion, The law is ultimately about power itself, the ways in which it is wielded, those who wield it, and those against whom it is wielded. In a time in which the notion of progress as a straight line has been viscerally debunked, when many rights that I took for granted are either on the chopping block or have been fully stripped away, in a time in which the freedom to dissent against suffering and oppression at home and abroad, the freedom to engage in political speech that challenges the status quo, is being suppressed, even by those who purport to value it. How we use our words in this time, in service of or in opposition to power, matters. Longtime NYU law professor Derek Bell and former NAACP Legal Defense Fund attorney wrote in 1992 that the struggle for freedom is at bottom a manifestation of our humanity that survives and grows stronger through resistance to oppression, even if that oppression is never overcome. In her dissent in Shelby County, RBG quoted a familiar Martin Luther King Jr. line, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice." And then she added her own coda, "If there is a steadfast commitment to see the task through to completion." That commitment is not and never has been the work of one individual, of one lifetime. It's the work of all of us. I'm grateful to so many who have been doing that work before me, my friends, classmates, and colleagues who do it alongside me, and so many who will continue to do it when I'm gone. At the beginning of this speech, I talked about feeling inadequate to receive this award, like I hadn't done enough. That's a feeling I'm used to as a public defender, with too many clients, none of whom feels like they get the attention that they actually deserve. But I am grateful for the opportunity to get up every day and try. As Maryam Kaba tells us, hope is a discipline. May we all have the continued discipline to keep on hoping. Thank you.
Adjust this microphone down a little bit. Thank you, Shana, for sharing your wisdom, your experiences, and your commitment to justice, and for advocating for the queer community. It's truly an inspiration. You know, with all of us in this room and the concept that queerness is infinite, I don't know what power we all bring in this space, but taken together, I think it's quite powerful. Now, we would like to invite everyone to stay and enjoy refreshments, connect with each other, and we hope to see you all at future events. And let's give another massive round of applause to Shana for her incredible work.